I'm Rachel Garshick-Cleet. I'm the section head of city and regional planning here at the Knowlton School of Architecture. And I have the delight of introducing Margaret Dewar, Professor Margaret Dewar from University of Michigan. Now be polite. Thank you. All right? You're going to be polite about this tonight, the University of Michigan? Okay. So her research is in the broad areas of economic development, housing and community development, urban environmental planning, and urban land use. And she's working on projects now that look at cities, what happens to cities following abandonment within them, and what's happened, and how to strengthen neighborhoods that are deteriorating because of that abandonment. And she's also looking at shrinking city context, where cities are losing population, not gaining population. A lot of what we do in planning or in other areas of the field, we expect that cities are going to continue to grow. And as we know, after the mortgage crisis and the foreclosure crisis, that's not the case. We've seen a lot of shrinkage. We've also seen shrinkage because of economic change in Rust Belt cities. So this is an important context for us to think about as we go forward with our disciplines. Her 2013 book, The City After Abandonment, is co-edited with June Manning Thomas, who was here a couple years ago, actually. And she's working with Professor Thomas Lendang and a PhD student, investigating whether and how residents and community-based organizations can save their neighborhoods from disadvantage, from disinvestment that the mortgage foreclosure crisis caused. She's also looking at how land use change occurs in cities where there's very little demand for property. And she's also trying to, she's looking at this across many disciplines, working with faculty in law, landscape, architecture, water ecology, public health, sociology, and civil engineering to study how land use transitions from a derelict structure through demolition to green stormwater infrastructure. How do you transition properties that have been brownfields into green fields? Can you do that? She's also looking at the remaking of place and places where there's been the most abandonment of cities, and looking at how we preserve affordable housing in that context, especially when there's no market to maintain interest in that housing, to redevelop it over time. Professor Dewar earned a PhD in urban studies and planning from MIT. She has a master's of city planning from Harvard, and an AB from Wellesley College. And I give you Professor Dewar.
Thank you, Rachel. And I'm just going to quickly answer a question that everyone asks me when they find out I went to Wellesley College. Yes, I did know her. She was ahead of me in college, but we overlapped enough and we were doing research on the same topics when she was a senior and I was a junior, so we used to have to meet at the circulation desk and trade books. So as Rachel actually said some of the things I was about to say. So planners are focused on development, managing it, incentivizing it, encouraging it, controlling it, and even in a shrinking city like Detroit that's lost population since the 1950s, that's where most planners' efforts go. So these are images from the fastest growing parts of the city. On the left is what's called Midtown, and that's an area that you can see has numerous anchor institutions at Wayne State University, the arts area, a major medical center, and it's being developed with a lot of input from foundations. There are lots of development projects going on there and lots of interest. Then the middle image is of the new hockey arena area. That's that red blob right there. And these are the other sports arenas that have been built recently. That, too, is a hub of activity and potential development and development. And then moving farther south, this is all in the spine of the of Detroit's Main Street, down the middle of the city, Woodward Avenue, it's called. And that this is Gilbert Land farther south, where Dan Gilbert, the billionaire from Cleveland, has purchased large numbers of office buildings. And this is his plan for what that area will be. And there, too, there's development occurring and lots of planning focus. And even in areas where there's really not much potential for any development, that's what planners focus on. In these neighborhoods of Detroit that have lost so much population, there's not going to be a lot of activities that would be development could actually do more damage, because adding housing when the demand for housing is so weak will undermine will undermine rents and undermine sales values potentially. So the challenge is, how do we rethink what we do? How do we rethink planning practice? How do we figure out how to do planning in places where there's not going to be much, if any, development? I've just given you examples from Detroit, but this isn't an isolated issue facing Detroit. This map, you can see the white circles up there. Those are the cities, that large cities, that have lost a great deal of their population down. Here's New Orleans. So you see it's mainly from St. Louis, east across the Midwest, and then in the Northeast and Mid-Atlantic, and then some cities across the South. So it's really something, as Rachel said, that lots of cities are needing to confront. So I believe planners should be doing a much better job of managing change, making better quality of life. These are not cities where we should say, yeah, we don't do anything there. Though one of my colleagues said that to me, and also quite a few students have said, but we don't do that. I think they should. We should. It's not just a question for practice. It's an issue for knowledge. How do we understand what's going on in such cities, and how do we then incorporate that into our bodies of knowledge to then teach folks like you how to understand such cities better and how to be better planners or take other roles in such cities. So we have what we call the Detroit School of Urban Studies that's supposed to be provocative, and it's really about how does thinking about Detroit-like cities change the questions that we ask and the answers we pursue in the many disciplines that contribute to urban studies. So how do we understand differently such cities? Or how do we understand urban studies more broadly, actually in growing cities as well, because of the insights we get from these shrinking cities? So what I'm going to do is talk about three questions from the perspective with respect to three of my research projects, parts of three of my research projects that are in varying degrees of progress, and then address what we learn about practice, what we learn about what the implications are for practice, what the implications are for knowledge. And the three questions are, what does a city become after abandonment? How do people remake the city? What goes on in those areas where people don't visit so often? What does it look like? What happens there? Second, what makes a difference in what a city becomes after abandonment? And this is particularly important to planners. What are the levers of change? What is it about what programs, what policies, what political relationships, what social relationships among neighbors, what federal efforts make a difference? And so one can see some of that by comparing cities that have lost population but have taken different approaches. And finally, what should a city become after abandonment? We planners need to always be thinking about, well, what should happen? What's the future? What do we want the future to be? So how do we think about that? So the first question is going to be, is what does a city become after abandonment? This is an area called Brightmoor in Detroit. As you can see in the area map over there on your right, Brightmoor's in the far northwest part of the city. And it has experienced very high levels of abandonment and disinvestment. The light gray, can you see the light gray? Those are all vacant lots. The yellowish are still occupied. So you can see a huge amount of vacant land through the middle of Brightmoor. Brightmoor was built very hurriedly in the 1920s to house people coming from Appalachia to work in the Rouge plant from Ford Motor. And the housing was built very badly, usually a house built in 10 hours. And they were built without plumbing and without central heating. And the developer said, they're coming from Appalachia, they're used to living this way, so they can make improvements as they earn money at the factory. Well, it very quickly became a slum, of course, when people lived densely this way. And it was, as population dropped in the city, it was one of the places people left early because it was so undesirable. So now what's going on is that, and this map shows, people are taking over adjacent lots, side lots. This map shows in red the properties that where there's a house where someone has taken over an adjacent lot. Not only that, so that's quite a bit of enlargement of properties, but in addition, there are quite a few properties where someone in a house has taken over at least two adjacent lots, maybe five, maybe six. And so they are essentially replatting in a way because there's been no official combination of lots, but they are now remaking the place in ways that I would not have expected. But nearly 60% of those properties that are in side lots or the blots, meaning a chunk of property that's between the size of a lot and a block, they weren't owned by the homeowners using them as of 2013. And of those, a large percent, 43%, were owned by a government. Another 15% of those were owned by a nonprofit, CDC. So those, you know, might be tolerant of such uses, but the rest, a lot, were owned by a large number of individuals. If those individuals came back, they could reclaim that property unless the property had been occupied so long that that certain laws allow the squatter to make claims on ownership. So what does this mean for knowledge? One of my PhD students, Matthew Weber, has been working on a dissertation looking at the development of informal ownership in cities, the dissolution of formal ownership in Detroit. He found that in neighborhoods like Brightmoor that have lost at least 70% of their households from the peak, about 10% of the properties are now squatted, vacant of the lots are squatted. It's a low number a low estimate because he can't tell which houses are squatted, are also occupied by squatters. So that's one way that property is not owned by the people using it. Another way is that there's properties that have not gone through probate after the death of an owner. There are properties that were improperly foreclosed for taxes titles are clouded. And so what's happening is that more and more property in these areas is becoming informally owned. which means the owner does not have any legal rights and can't get a mortgage, and there are a lot of rights that formal ownership conveys. In addition, though, for body of knowledge, the literature on property ownership really says that property goes from being informally owned to being formally owned, as we see in developing countries. There has not been anything that has shown that actually in the United States, property that was formally owned is now informally owned. And the reasons have to do with poverty, low property value. For instance, if your parents die and you're living in their house, to take that house through probate, if you are in poverty and you have very low value of your property, say your property's worth about $5,000, it can cost such a huge amount to go through probate, such a huge percent of the value of the house that to go through probate, and so far outside your means that you don't do it. So that then becomes informally owned property. But what about practice? So I'll show you what one of these blots looks like. So that's a house, and then to the right in the picture, there's a lot that's been taken over, landscaped. You can see the fence, 6 feet high fence, with an interesting sidewalk installed. Then on the other side, they've put in a driveway. They have another lot. They have a garage at the back. They have a garden. And then walking along that front sidewalk farther, there's what they've done with landscaping further on that lot. And then on the other side of that red fence on the right, they have a corn growing and they have squash growing. And if I had taken, if I had kept taking pictures, you would have seen apple trees and grapevines. And so they have taken over about 5-6 additional lots. So why? They did it, they said, they talked to a reporter who said, they said, well, we want our property look good. We want to be in an environment we enjoy. And would you look at that mess across the street? And so there's that ruin that should be demolished. And then there's an area that's been mowed, and you can tell by the how close together the marks of the mower are that it was done by an individual instead of by one of the city-wide body mowers. So someone is maintaining that independently. So they did it to try to maintain quality of life for their immediate environment. They put up the high fence because of the crime wave that came with crack cocaine in the 80s. And here's another one. And you can see in this case that safety issue is really clear. That dog was very noisy and definitely made one not want to get too close. So there are these multiple reasons that people have blotted, and they have remade the place into a place they want to live that's better than it was, would have been for them in the past. Well, and they've done this as people who don't have a lot of money, and who 70% of the people in that area are in poverty, and yet they have invested a huge amount of effort and energy to remake the place, and I consider them valuable residents that where planning and policy should be encouraging them to stay and trying to do things that might reinforce their efforts and improve their quality of life. In contrast, the last mayor of Detroit said, we've just got to clear out those areas. We can't afford to provide services. We're just going to clear them out, close them down. That didn't happen, and the new mayor says every neighborhood deserves a future. It just, the futures are different. There are many things that could be done in this area to restructure services so they didn't cost as much as they do when provided, fully provided. For instance, people in rural areas, and this is now semi-rural, are push their garbage cans out to the end of their long driveways. Could people push their garbage cans to one street instead of a garbage truck going up and down every street twice for just a handful of pickups? You know, that kind of thing. Lots of possibilities exist. So the second question, what makes a difference in what a city becomes after abandonment? And Rachel mentioned this research project too. This is the distribution of mortgage foreclosures in across Detroit. The dark colors are where the mortgage foreclosures were the highest percent of the structures that could have mortgages. We don't know they all did, but it was the potential number that could. And so you can see the darkest colors are in the outskirts. And some of the rates are extremely high, 40% to 62% is the darkest color of those structures went through mortgage foreclosure. Huge numbers. This, in contrast, is a map of where the vacant lots are. And it's what residential structures still have a housing structure on them. And the blue areas are the ones with the fewest vacant lots. 96 to 100% of the properties still have a house on them. That's actually more than in my neighborhood. And then the lighter blue is still 89 to 96%. So, but then when you look at the two maps together, you can see that the mortgage foreclosures hit those areas of most intact neighborhoods the hardest. And not the red areas where the vacancies are the greatest. So you could imagine that those remaining people in the red areas would have been removed by mortgage foreclosures. But no, that's not where they hit. So therefore, those intact neighborhoods faced substantial threat. This is a really simple image of how mortgage foreclosures hurt a neighborhood. They lead to declines in property values and increases in vacancy, property vandalism, and crime, and homeowners' confidence is undermined, which leads more people to decide to leave. And the neighborhood changes more from owner-occupied to renter-occupied, and there's more people decide, I don't know that I'll put a new roof on because I don't know if I'm going to be here this long. So there's more disinvestment. So the question that really interested me and my colleagues was, can neighbors save their neighborhoods? Because we saw a great deal of effort of people trying. And I teach a class where students work on it's the final master's project class where students work on developing a plan with community partners to advance the partners' agendas. And so we were getting calls, can you help us figure out how to stop the mortgage foreclosures? What should we do with all this vacant property? So we dived into that and developed developed plans that were then turned into manuals for training for people in these neighborhoods. But then we wanted my colleagues Lan Dung and June Manning Thomas and PhD student Eric Seymour wanted to know, so did this do any good? And so we looked first. We were most interested in those strong neighborhoods, those neighborhoods so vital to a city where properties still have value, where people still are able to pay property taxes and so forth. So we looked at where are the strong neighborhoods, looking at ones that had the same trajectory from 1990 to 2000 and looked about the same in 2000, as were similar in 2000, so just prior to the mortgage foreclosures. And these blues are the strong neighborhoods. So we chose three case study areas where we found out from looking at data and talking to lots of people, there were particularly intense efforts by residents to save their neighborhoods. So number one is a neighborhood called Grandmont Rosedale, and then number two is a neighborhood called Morningside, and number three is a neighborhood called East English Village. Here's what those neighborhoods look like. So they're not the usual images of Detroit, but interesting historical structures that neighbors make sure continue to look occupied. And so there was a lot of people dedicated in those neighborhoods who wanted to keep living there. And this was not a race issue. These neighborhoods are very heavily African American. So the whites who were still there had chosen to live with African Americans. There was not white flight going on in any of the neighborhood preservation effort. So what had happened to these places? This is their the story of their mortgage foreclosures. And you can see there's different patterns. So Morningside, which was one of those ones over on the east side, has this very high peak early and then tapers off. So this says to me they were particularly hard hit by subprime mortgage foreclosures early in the mortgage foreclosure crisis. This is all the other strong neighborhoods, the ones we didn't pick. And you can see their pattern does mirror, looks a little bit like that Morningside pattern. At one point, Morningside was the area of top two places in the nation for the rate of mortgage foreclosures, that and Slavic Village in Cleveland. And then the other two neighborhoods are these lines. And because they were higher over here, I think what was going on there is, yes, they had some subprime mortgages that went bad, but they also had a lot of people who lost their homes with the recession, when they lost jobs or when their house lost value and their loan was way more than their house was worth. And this shows what happened to that. You can see in Grandmont Rosedale, which is the top line right there, housing value fell from about 100, median sales price of a residential structure, fell from about 150,000 in 2003 to, what is it, like 20,000 in just a few years. And this is data from CoreLogic. They gave us a data grant of millions of records for this period, so we were able to see how sales prices had changed. But you can see all the neighborhoods suffered greatly, and that this is the other strong neighborhoods, all those ones with less efforts. So even in 2012, they're down less than $10,000 for a house when they had been up above 85,000, say. So people were underwater, and therefore some of the mortgage foreclosures were due to people saying, why am I going to keep paying a mortgage of, say, 80,000 when my house is now only worth 20? So this was a huge hit these neighborhoods took. About 35% of the properties went through mortgage foreclosure in this period, which means that people lost the people they knew, their neighbors they might have worked with in the past. So social capital was considerably undermined. So could they hold it together? And this seemed like an extreme situation because of this huge drop in housing value, the loss of social capital due to so many neighbors leaving, more than a third. And this, at the same time, the city government's lack of capacity. So we decided to try to see if they had had an effect or could have an effect. And we've been working on this for almost 4 years because we've been going to all these neighborhood meetings and seeing what they're doing and hearing what they're trying and not able to do and so forth. They're trying just about everything one can think of. And this is some of it. And they are kind of, they go to the Reclaiming Vacant Properties conferences and learn all the new tactics and go back and practice them. So did this have an effect? And the great news is that it did in two of the neighborhoods. So this one is Grandma Rosedale, and this one is East English Village. This is the difference in the percent difference in the sales price from in comparison to the other strong neighborhoods, those ones that didn't have as much effort. So this is where the other strong neighborhoods change is zero, and then you can see, therefore, that the change in sales value is much higher with those in those two neighborhoods. And that's controlling for a large number of other factors. But the story of one part of Grandma Rosedale, this is Minnick Park, looks very small area, 300 households, looks promising here, but then again, not here. So I think that we'll see. But Morningside, in contrast, pretty much didn't save itself. And in Morningside, June Thomas said, as we drove around, it's in free fall. It's just in such bad condition, and the neighborhood organizations have not been able, as you would know, if you've looked at neighborhood organizations, there's often conflict and disagreements, and that has taken over there, kept them from working well enough to have an effect. So now what we're working on is trying to explain Grandma Rosedale's success as kind of a best case, and we'll see what we can say about that. So what does this mean for knowledge? Well, there's been long time people have believed in that community efforts make a difference in neighborhoods, but external shocks are also a huge force in the fortunes of neighborhoods, and therefore the question is, so how much can local effort do, and is there a limit to it? Are there tipping points where up to a certain amount of external shock it can have an effect, but after that, no. But what we've found is that under extraordinary shock of this huge loss of neighbors, the really complete collapse of all government, and government was not really present in these neighborhoods, and the loss in housing value, that even under those extreme circumstances, collective efficacy, as Robert Sampson calls it, had an impact, meaning that the social capital, the social networks, the people working together, plus their community institutions of a strong CDC that provided infrastructure for that effort, those did have an effect. So prior research has shown that no matter what the income level of a neighborhood, social efficacy or collective efficacy has an effect on decreasing crime. Well, this shows that it can have an effect, doesn't necessarily have an effect on a huge external shock. So what does it mean for practice? It means that reinforcing community development networks, CDC networks, for instance, needs to be very high priority. That city governments need to be doing things to reinforce the community development industry. Detroit's city government has not done that. It means that having a local intermediary for training people and training and channeling funding and training people in community development can have an effect. And that planners are not just kind of running in place when they work on those things. So it also says a lot of detailed stuff about what you do with a vacant property, but I'm not going into all that. And then, final question, what should a city become? So in the last few years, we've seen a number of shrinking cities plans. One is Detroit Future City, shown here. Another's Youngstown 2010. Another is Reimagining Flint. And Cleveland has kind of tiptoed around with their imagining a sustainable Cleveland. This one, Detroit Future City, shows on the left current land use. And the yellow is residential. On the right, the future land use that the planners thought should happen within the next 50 years. And so it shows a massive transformation from residential to green-blue uses. And those are a variety of them. So I thought, so how does such land use occur? We think in planning that market pressures lead to redevelopment of a property for a higher and better use when there's a sufficient rent gap. But in these cases, there's no rent gap. Maybe the highest and best use is a dumped on vacant lot, overgrown. So how do you get to these positive future uses? How do you transition it? So I had the opportunity to work on a project with the people that Rachel mentioned, a landscape architect, Joan Nassauer, a law faculty member, a civil engineer, and a sociologist and public health person, and to look at what I thought was going to be the easiest transition of all. City officials are demolishing all these buildings, and they have basements, and those are holes, and why not go from demolition, derelict structure, to demolition to green stormwater infrastructure, where you do something with the basement, maybe, and then you can hold water, and that's the transition. So these are images of with our project, we have actually gotten four of these installed, these sites, working with the Detroit Water and Sewage Department and the Land Bank Authority. So you can see the transition here from house to demolition. That's the lower left is our garden in last fall, and on the right is a rendering of one of the gardens. But it didn't happen quite that way because the timing of demolition and the timing of installation of green infrastructure couldn't be coordinated. Too many bureaucratic issues and rules and all that. And then this had to be on lots where there could be two demolitions in order for the slope to the water retention area wouldn't be too great. But anyway, so I have been looking at governance. How does governance help or interfere with this? Because this should show us what has to happen or should happen with the way various governments, nonprofits, and other institutions interact in order to enable this kind of land use transition. And what the law professor and I have discovered is really this is incredibly difficult, that it would be really requires restructuring of government city government, and that people have not yet envisioned as they've imagined this kind of plans. So one issue is that, again, all the attention's on where development's taking place. So in Cleveland, for instance, on the right, that's an installation of green infrastructure where there was a new hotel going in at University Circle. The land bank gave them a lot in return for their, so they have a bigger space in return for their doing all that installation of green infrastructure. The Environmental Protection Agency is saying you have to do something about your combined sewage overflows. You are, in the case of Cleveland, this is under a court, a consent decree. In Detroit, it's a permit. But the mayor in neither city really is into this. They have a lot of other issues, and it's quite understandable that putting in green infrastructure is not their highest. But in some cities, mayors have made that a priority. So in Baltimore and Gary, for instance, they actually have offices, people who are supposed to be working on this, and they have offices of sustainability. But that's a really different kind of organization. Then another issue is that there's no plan. This is the extent of the plan in Detroit. So huge areas, these are priority areas, but that doesn't mean anything. And it doesn't mean that any particular nonprofit, say, who does have interest in reuse of such property could count on getting the land and reusing it. And another issue is an underemphasis on how to strengthen neighborhoods using this green infrastructure. It could help deter disinvestment and population loss, maybe, but that hasn't been the focus. These are two sites installed in Cleveland that were trying to do that. But there aren't very many others I could have photographed. It's not large numbers. And maybe the biggest initial hurdle is that city, for anyone wanting to do this, like nonprofits, the city systems aren't adapted. So you don't know who to talk to. New routines are needed, but no one has them in place. And you don't know how to get a site plan review. Is there even one required? We were told that they weren't required. No information on permitting or inspections, and no one inspected what we did. I think they should have, but someone could have put in something fairly destructive or something that would fall apart and be a mess. This is one of our gardens last fall, and this is in July after it hadn't rained or had water flowing into it for 6 weeks. So what does this mean for knowledge, and what does it mean for practice? And this is the project that's least far along of these three that I've mentioned. So I have the two kind of come together. The big thing I have discovered is that what I thought was the easiest transition, it wasn't going to have to be a huge amount of investment, just hold that water there, is actually incredibly difficult, way more difficult than I thought. The governance issues are really complex, and they're fascinating. And yet they have to be resolved planners need to work on helping to resolve them in order for this kind of transition to occur. And that is just barely beginning. I'm fortunate that I'm getting to talk, to work with people and say, in water and sewage department saying we have to know about site plan review. Who's going to do site plan reviews? And they have actually said, oh yeah, we do need to work on that. And yesterday, two people said are actually getting our procedures in place. Great. So in a way, I'm doing practice by working on this project with them. So what I say is that we need to reorient how we think about practice and the potential for knowledge building to derive more from and contribute more to such cities as like Detroit, Cleveland, Toledo, Akron, Dayton, and I know I could go on and name many more Ohio cities. So, questions? This is our garden too, one of our gardens.
What questions do you have for Professor Dewar?
There isn't a lot of working together in some of those neighborhoods where there's a high level of blotting. It's where their population is denser and higher percent of homeowners and those kinds of characteristics where there's a much more social capital evident. But some community organizers have been working on trying to increase that in those more vacant areas through gardens and art. But in general, zoning doesn't have to change, so that's not an issue that they work on to bring people together. Did that answer your question? Or, okay.
What other questions are there? Go ahead, from the back.
So I just have kind of a general question about this idea of abandoned cities. What kinds of things do these cities have in common? Is there like some one causal mechanism that like creates all of this population leaving, or is it just sort of random?
Cities shrink for numerous reasons. The ones I'm most interested in and have studied the most have lost population and households since, well, in Youngstown's case, 1930, and others mostly 1950 or 1960, and they've lost them because of suburbanization. And then starting around after World War II, loss of employment and industrial restructuring, so that led to transfer of jobs to other regions and to other parts of the world. So Detroit, for instance, has lost more than 95% of its manufacturing jobs since World War II, partly due to technology, partly due to regional redistribution of where autos are built, that kind of thing. But some cities shrink mainly because of changes in their household size. They're more European cities that have lost for that reason, for instance.
And then in the blue shirt in the back.
Yes, I'll have a question. What did you take permission to start working on the building blocks? Where did you get the buy-in?
That was a huge governance issue. every step along the way. I mean, they're a success, right, because they happened. Whether or not they held water, we're trying to learn about that. But the land bank owned the property. So that we thought, okay, that makes it doable. But the city's lawyers thought of all kinds of reasons no one should be able to walk on the property or go onto the property or do anything there because of liability. And even though it was the Water and Sewer Department who was going to put stuff there, and that's another city agency, then how could we walk? We walk on it to do the testing and planting and stuff. Finally, the two heads of the two departments got together on a field trip to New Orleans to look at green infrastructure, and they agreed this has to happen. That is the opposite of a routine. That is, you know, you're never going to get land use transition of any scale when that's required. So we finally got a lease that said, or the university's lawyers said their insurance covered us, and we have a some kind of lease that says we have a right to walk on it. DWSD has, Water and Sewer Department has the lease of the land from the land bank.
The land bank wouldn't sell it because the board thought, well, maybe that would get in the way of future development. The house, as you can see next to the garden, is now abandoned and burned and will have to be demolished. I mean, it's not an area, if the board members had been in this neighborhood, they would say that, so.
So I guess building on that question, it seems like there's a huge amount of tension between wanting to validate these informal uses that you're documenting, right? And cities thinking of that as a sort of valid reuse strategy for vacant lands in the city, and then these institutional structures, which some of which are necessary, like plan review, and some of which are
right.
Constructions.
Right.
Have you seen anything that is a medium there? Or the
well, to their credit, the city officials now use the term blots, and they want to make, and they talk about not wanting to put more barriers in the way of people. So we'll see. And I'm hoping that this, our experiment can demonstrate certain rules and all that have to change. We'll see. That's what, it's so interesting. I mean, I get to study that. So.
In the front row.
Doesn't seem like there's really been anything done to sort of stop banks from bundling some type of mortgages, and property values in Columbus have gone up like crazy amounts in the last 3 years.
Mm.
And I mean, it feels like 2008 all over again to me. Do you kind of feel some like tremors before the? Do you feel like this could happen again soon?
Let's restate the question, because I'm not sure the people in the back actually heard it. So I think the question is basically, in Columbus, we have a very different experience, and we're seeing bundling of mortgages and bundling of properties, and it seems the market seems to be heating up again, right?
Mm-hmm.
So is that a cause for concern, or is that a recovery?
Well, what I hope it is. Not a bubble, another bubble, but the things that brought on the crash before were a bubble, but not in places like Detroit. It was I think Alan Malik calls it a bubblette, you know, just a little one. But anyway, but then the huge numbers of subprime mortgages mortgages with exotic terms, which really people had to keep being able to refinance to be able to pay. And when the bubble burst or stopped growing, they couldn't refinance and get out of it. So they went into foreclosure. And so is that happening again? So are the subprime mortgages, or the mortgages with very bad terms, balloon payments, escalating interest rates, Is that putting people into a situation where they could, again, get to a point where they couldn't refinance and they would have no choice? And there have been changes in government regulations, but usually the private sector is way ahead of government regulation. You may know more specifics on that.
What I know is that mortgage credit right now is still very tight. It's starting to recover, but we're not seeing the variety of subprime mortgages that we had, and we're seeing a greatly decreased access to credit. So, I think Nick, and then we'll go back in the back of the room again.
So I'm a little interested in the resiliency of these sites. When was your first project, and how has the community taken them since? Are they invested in the sites? Have you seen a resurgence of vandalism or dumping? What can you tell us about it since?
That's one of the things we're tracking. Well, for one thing, the water and sewage department is doing the maintenance for 3 years. And this is the first summer these have been in. So they're doing mowing and weeding and clearing the inlet area of trash and where the water comes off the street into the site. And we have not seen any vandalism. Well, initially there were some plants stolen, but not, but then we put, had a ceremony where kids put ribbons on all the plants, and so now they haven't disappeared. We have not seen anything else bad happen. What the neighbors say is that when something happens like this, the particularly egregious other activities have plenty of other space elsewhere, so they move away. Like, there was a drug house across the street from one of the gardens that now isn't. Someone was driving behind the sites with a vehicle, now isn't. So we'll see. Our public health people are interviewing a lot of people in the area about their commitment to the place, their effects on of the place, those sites on their sense of neighborhood, and that kind of thing. And are they helping to fix, keep it clean and stuff? We'll learn more. It's become a tourist, a site where people take tours, one of them on a main street. So there are these numerous visitors who help enliven the street. And people are clamoring for more from other neighborhoods. So the neighborhood, Grandma Rosedale, that I mentioned, they have worked to get the Water and Sewerage Department committed to putting one in some land they own, the CDC owns. And others across the city are working on that too. So that's nice for, we'll see how it works.
Okay, one last question. Another question? Oh, thanks, sorry. Go ahead.
So in the slide with the different sectors, there was the addition of extra sectors. You talked about green and blue sectors, that this large green
yes.
area that was kind of in the middle of Detroit. What was that? Was that green forestry? Or?
No, it hasn't happened yet. That's the 50-year plan. So right now it is still zoned residential. It is still, there may well be a lot of vacant land there that's overgrown, but, and some isolated house, and some housing,
so
but
what
it is still.
What was the proposed blue sector?
I think blue is what I'm calling green, stormwater, handling stormwater. But the green was also industries that would depend on growing things like farming or forestry or growing some crops for energy, things like that.
And my follow-up was, will that divide the community? I mean, with that large area of not populated people anymore from the downtown Detroit?
I'll go back to that. I don't remember. Yeah. But it will be more hospitable to go through than it is now. I hope.
Well, let's give another round of applause.